What qualities should a spiritual leader have? What qualities does a guy need to be developing towards spiritual leadership? And these are actually qualities that I'm going to throw out that I think are kind of true of spiritual leadership in general. In fact, I've garnered them from different passages in the Bible that just talk about leadership in general. But they're going to come into play big as a husband, okay? This is the first one. I would say probably the number one qualification of a leader when it comes to Jesus' perspective, when it comes to the Christian perspective, is a servant. It's like it. I might have there Mark 10, 42 through 45. What's happening in this passage is James and John have gone and they've tried to kind of go behind the other disciples' backs to see if they can be sitting at Jesus' right hand and at his left hand. Basically, they want to be like next in charge in this kingdom that Jesus is setting up, okay? And the other disciples find out about it, and they're not real happy, okay? So they come and they start talking with Jesus about this, and they're complaining, and Jesus says this to them. Jesus called them together, and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." And this concept comes up several times in the Bible, that a leader, contrary to everything the world does, a leader's job is to put the needs of someone else above his own, of everyone else above his own. That's why John says, when Jesus was in the upper room and he knew that he had come from God and that God had given him all authority, the very next line is, he got down and he washed his disciples' feet. That's the idea, that's the example Jesus sets for us. And so this is first and foremost that wants to be a spiritual leader, is that you are a servant. The next is this, and this comes from Acts 6. The church is looking for some men to help serve some of the widows in the church, to make sure that they're getting food, to make sure that they're getting taken care of. And so the apostles stand up and say, we need you to select men, and I want you to select men that are known for being full of the Spirit and wisdom. Those are the things he says, full of the Spirit and wisdom. And that's not quite as, we always think of full of the Spirit as sort of this intangible kind of, man, they're super spiritual and that kind of. Full of the Spirit means their life is just defined by the Holy Spirit. Like, if you want to know if you're full of the Spirit or not, I would ask you, how much say does the Holy Spirit have in your life? Mm-hmm. And by that I mean, like, how much say does the Holy Spirit's word that he inspired have in your life? And how much, when you feel him nudging you, how much say does he have in your life? And that's what it means to be full of the Spirit. That's what it means to be full of wisdom. One of Paul's favorite words in the pastoral epistles are what? 1st, 2nd Timothy and Titus, right? Talking about pastoral leadership, one of his favorite words he throws around is godliness. Godliness is actually, it's probably his word for what we now call spiritual. And that person's really spiritual. Paul would have said, and I actually like this word more, he's godly. He's defined by the things of God. And that's one of the big qualifications, as a person who is defined by the things of God is who you should be. Next one is this, integrity. Oops, did that come up there? Oh, there it is, integrity. This one I read the passage here, but write down 1 Timothy 3. The word is, and this is the, like when Paul says, when he's giving qualifications for an elder or a pastor or a deacon, his umbrella term, the one that usually starts off his list, is above reproach. Like all the other things he puts under there is this idea above reproach. That is a person who has so much integrity that you know that they are who they appear to be, that they are in private who they are in public, that you can't level accusations against them. Like those accusations slide off because everybody knows who that man is. And here's the truth, is if nobody else knows who you are, your family is going to know who you are. Yeah. Your wife is going to know who you are. And so you need to be a man of integrity. Someone who is in public, but they are in private, and vice versa. Those things going to be. This is also, by the way, like why I'll just say it. There, I think a lot of affairs start to come from this idea that, like, your wife is the only person who knows you, really, and so she's the one person who's not really impressed by you anymore. Okay. And so, like, specifically, I think this is probably true, that the tragedy of how many, like, ministers fall into adultery, I think it is because there are a lot of women in their church who can be impressed by them, and they can get up and preach and teach and look really cool, and it sounds really nice to hear them saying sweet things about how godly and cool you are, and you go home and your wife isn't saying those things because she knows you. and it's true, like, my wife, she's encouraging and she's loving and she respects me and I love those things, but she also knows me better than anybody, and she's not as impressed with me. As in, not that people are super impressed with me, but however impressed they are, she's down here at it, okay? That's just the way it's going to go. And because it's not because she thinks less of me, it's because she knows the real me. And so the more and more my public and private match up together as to who I am, the better that's going to be.
By the way, that sucks.
Yeah.
and it's awesome at the same time.
Let me just say this, it is true. And here's what happens, is I think guys hear this, that they'll go somewhere, and it doesn't have to be pastors, it can be anybody, and they go to work, and they've got this friend, this girl, this woman, or whatever, who keeps talking about how awesome they are, and she loves me, and she respects me, and she thinks highly of me, and so they start thinking, maybe this is who I'm supposed to be with, and I'll tell you the truth, they can leave their wife, and in 2 years, that woman is going to know everything about them, and they're not going to be impressed with them either, you know what I mean? So the truth is, there's no, the grass is greener, but then you go over there, and the grass realizes you suck too. So, like, it doesn't fit, okay? It's never going to work out.
Getting married is like, when you get married, it's like you're marrying a mirror that reflects flaws.
Yeah.
And you can get really mad at the mirror, and then realize, okay, dang it, it's me, you know? And so that took first 5 years of my marriage, was figuring out, why is she always pointing out my flaws? And I'm like, oh, she's just exposing them.
Crap. Yeah, let me make sure. Okay, gotcha, it's all there. Gentle, not quarrelsome. Let me talk about that one first. That's also actually 1 Timothy 3 and the qualifications for an elder. There are several there, but I took ones that I felt like specifically fit well with the husband thing. Gentle, not quarrelsome. I'll tell you this. You do not lead your wife by winning arguments. Right? Do not. You're not going to be able to argue your way to a better marriage. And that's just true. And Amy will tell you, and she's told me this before. She said, Drew, whenever we can argue, and I know this, you'll always win, but it doesn't mean you're always right. And it doesn't mean that you always come to understand me. And that's not because I'm more intelligent, okay? That's not because it's just because I'm a little bit more comfortable expressing myself with words. It's half of what I do, you know what I mean? That's part of my job. And so she said, you can win every time. I'm not going to be able to win that argument, but it doesn't necessarily mean you're right, and it doesn't necessarily mean you've heard me out.
Yeah.
And that's huge, to be able to understand that my role is to be the one who makes sure that there is peace in our house. And by that I don't mean, okay, this is where you can get into the passive side that I fall into a lot. I don't want to rock the boat, and so I don't want to make the hard decisions, or I don't want to call us to kind of a higher standard of devotion. I don't mean that, but I mean when there is tension in the house, when there is conflict in the house, like I should be the peacekeeper, and my job is not to win arguments. My job is to make sure that there's peace between me and my wife, which brings us to this next one, initiator, and I don't actually have a text for this. This is just kind of a practical thing, and Chandler talked a little bit about it in one of the series clips that Matt Chandler, in one of the clips you listen to in your table groups, but the husband is to initiate, a spiritual leader is to initiate. I would say that you ought to initiate in conflict resolution. That is, you ought to be the one who humbles himself first and apologizes. I'd say that the husband ought to initiate in like spiritual conversations, talking about things like the word, talking about what's going on in your life, initiating prayer. Hey, let's pray about this. Hey, let's spend some time praying before we go to bed. Hey, let's, like, that ought to be, I'm not saying a wife can't ever bring that up. That's not what I'm saying at all. It's not that a wife can't bring up spiritual conversation. Wives, you don't have to wait for him to do that stuff, but husbands, you ought to be doing that stuff. So it's not wives don't do that, it's husbands do that, okay? That's what we're kind of getting at here, is husbands ought to be doing that thing. And I think they also, in some sense, initiate in the direction of the family. That doesn't mean that they, that does not mean that they are the sole decider in the direction of the family. Like, whenever I make a decision about our family when it comes to finances, or when it comes to what we're going to start doing as a family to try and grow, or whatever those things are, like, I never make that myself. I hope that I'm thinking through those and processing, coming up with ideas and bringing them to my wife. We talk about those things together. I wanna try to initiate, and I want us to decide that thing, those things together as a team, as a couple.
Yeah. Hopefully, guys, by now you should be getting really nervous. Okay, that's
a lot to live up to.
There's a lot. And we're gonna, we'll